Hey everyone, my name is Helen. Welcome to the Shrimpy Miggy channel. Go ahead and grab a tea, grab a big old drink of water, grab a notepad, or just make some notes on your iPhone. We're gonna be doing a jumbo edition of solutions for thin hair and hair loss, because let me tell you, I have dealt with this 4 years now. I've been detailing my story for at least 2 years here on YouTube. So I've got lots of videos, lots of playlists about all the different things that you can do, solutions and stuff like that. But I wanted to make this jumbo edition video for you guys where I just tackle everything and sort of unpick all the different sticking points that you might be having when it comes to just whether you're sort of starting on your hair loss sort of journey or whether you're deep into it and you just have questions. I get questions all the time. I get them here on my YouTube channel, I get them over on Instagram, and I read about it all the time. I'm deep into this stuff and I have a lot of knowledge that I wanna share with you, so let's get into it. But I just have to have a sip of tea first. Okay, so I'm gonna talk about my story just quickly, but I'm gonna put down here below just a timestamp. Go ahead and jump to this if you wanna jump straight into my do's and don'ts, but just a little bit about me. 3 years ago, I had no hair, and I've made a video about that. Go ahead and check that out, maybe after you've watched this. And since then, I've just been clawing my way back, okay? Clawing my way back. This is the result of 3 years of hard work. And let me tell you, it was not easy. I did not automatically grow back my beautiful, huge, voluminous hair. And it is, like, realistically, this is a third of the hair that I used to have, but I'm still happy with it. I'm still happy with what I've got. And so, listen, if any of these tips help you, I am just so happy. If they do, please do give me a like. Don't forget to subscribe and watch through to the end, because you're gonna be surprised at the different questions that I answer here and the do's and don'ts. And I'll be very surprised if you don't learn something interesting by the end of this. The first sort of don't that I wanna address is the zero effort people out there. And I promise you it's gonna get better, but hear me out through this. And these are the people, and maybe this applies to you, but hopefully not, that just don't really want to do anything but expecting their hair to sort of magically look like it did XYZ number of years ago. Listen, if you're going to put in zero effort, you're going to look like you've done zero effort. If you want to really address your hair loss and your thinning hair, it is effortful. Whether that means you do it by getting a wig or a top or just the other methods, you're going to have to put some effort into it. And I hear people complain about this all the time. They just don't want to do anything. They don't want to try anything. If you don't want to try Rogaine or Minoxidil, that's totally fine. That's a personal decision, or maybe one that you make with your healthcare provider. I'm not here to judge you for that. But if you don't want to try anything, you're not willing to try a topper, you're not really willing to try a spray, fibers, you're just expecting to brush your hair and wash it the same as you always did and expecting for some sort of magic to happen, like, that's realistically not going to happen. So I just wanted to address that straight off the hop. Don't do that. You have to be effortful. The next thing I want to talk about that comes up sometimes is about hair parting. And this is one that I feel like people don't feel like they have to do too much, like they're just going to wear their hair part the way they used to. Listen, I do not normally wear my hair split down the middle like this. This is a pretty unforgiving look and it's not the most flattering. A far more flattering part for me is right over here. That's where my hair naturally wants to part. But guess what, people? That's also where my thinnest area is, right here. So if I split it here, okay, it's going to look much thinner. Maybe this applies to you. If you have a lot of thinning hair and hair loss and it's all concentrated right here, then maybe consider wearing a really deep part. I know that those were big about 5 years ago and they're not as hot today, but honestly, you have to look around at your part and try some different things. This goes back to that point I was talking about like trying to put in zero effort and doing exactly what you used to. Like, those days are over. Get over it. Try something new. It took me a while, but I found that this part actually is gonna give me the fullest look. So that might be the case for you too. If you are finding that your usual part is just highlighting that, go to this side or just go really deep on this side. And there's lots of videos here on YouTube or just like quick tutorials, even online, just do a Google search for like deep side part and have a look at that, try that. Honestly, that might make your hair look, you know, 30% better than it did before. Are we realistically gonna look like we have a huge full head of hair by doing that? Maybe, maybe not. Everybody's hair is different, but just start there. Washing frequency is another question that I see a lot and seems to be some confusion, but I'm gonna tell you what works for me. Do wash your hair more frequently. I hear about people washing their hair. Oh, I wash my hair once every 7 days and look at all the hair that's fallen out, and they have like a huge fluffy bunny of hair. That's because you waited 7 days to wash your hair. If 50 to 100 strands fall out every single day, let's just say you're in a period of more hair loss. If you're losing 100 strands of hair a day and you don't wash it, you're not really brushing it that much, by the time that 7 days roll around, you're gonna have somewhere close to 700 strands of hair that are gonna come out either along that time, or maybe if your hair is more wavy or curly, predominantly when you wash your hair, it's gonna be a mess. So what I would say to that, and I will tell you just from what I've read from other dermatologists, and if you don't believe me, go ahead and watch Dr. Dre on YouTube, is that you can wash your hair much more frequently than that. Dr. Dre has said, I believe in her shower routine video, that you can wash it as much as your hair can tolerate. So if you want to wash your hair every second day and that's working for you and you're not having excessive dry hair or excessive dandruff or irritation, there's nothing wrong with sticking with that routine at all. For what it's worth, I wash my hair every second or third day. I find that if I really want it to look its best, every second day is the absolute best. Every third day, if I'm just feeling lazy or if it's the period where my hair is just not as oily, that works well. You gotta find what works for you, but I'm pretty sure that once a week, you might need to step it up a bit to get a better result for thin hair and hair loss. And we know, I don't know too much about DHT, but there is some evidence and some people get advice from doctors that DHT will block, you know, it's something that's on your scalp and you'll want to remove that by frequent washing and even using a DHT blocking shampoo, which I'm not going to be talking about because that's not an area of expertise for me, but there's a lot of info out there. Definitely go ahead and research it. But more washing is better than less frequent washing. Oils, scalp treatment. I hear people saying castor oil, it doesn't work. Should I use it? This is jojoba oil. I've never been one to put oil on my scalp. I just don't think for me it's going to work well. I don't want this occlusive oil blocking all my pores because I just don't think that putting oil, and if you don't believe me, definitely check with your dermatologist or healthcare provider. I don't feel like necessarily putting oil, like that's gonna block your pores, is the best idea for my scalp anyway. Why do I say this? My scalp, I don't have issues with dandruff. I don't have really too much flakiness or anything like that. My scalp is happy. It's pretty happy, so I'm just gonna leave it be, which for me means washing it every second day. I'm not gonna be starting messing with oils or putting like a leave-in conditioner on my scalp. No, for me. The other thing I was thinking, you know, we don't know too much about castor oil's actual effectiveness, sort of in relation to like Rogaine and minoxidil and stuff like that. But I will say, have we considered that maybe the massaging is really good for your scalp? Like there's nothing wrong with giving yourself a really good massage, so long as you've brushed out your hair really well so that you don't have any tangles that you're getting yourself stuck, you're getting your fingers stuck into. But I don't think any healthcare professional is gonna tell you not to massage your hair. I think it's probably one of the best things. It feels great. It's not gonna cause your hair to fall out more. Like, don't be ridiculous. Like, just giving yourself a gentle massage is not gonna cause your hair to fall out. But for the people that have said that they have had success with castor oil, I'm just so curious. Like, I do wonder if it's the massage element that's really helping them. So for me, no to the oil, yes to the massage. Hope that helps. Oh, and no to the leave-on scalp treatments, because if your scalp is not acting up, I would say don't mess with the pH on your skin, and that includes your scalp. My experience. Hydrating. Hair extensions. This is one I see pop up a lot. Should I get tape-in extensions? Should I get clip-in extensions? Should I get those little extensions that they put in with the little bead? Because they take a teeny little bit of hair from underneath and they put a little, and the way they attach it is like with a bead and it's sewn in. And the thinking with that is as your hair grows, the bead just gets lower. My thoughts on that, don't do it. Do not be putting any extensions in your hair. If you're having problems with thinning hair and hair loss, very often it's not from this underneath area. It's up here, and so I don't feel like extensions will give you more fullness. I feel, but there are potential downsides, right? If you use tape-in extensions, I've heard horror stories about people trying to remove those and it taking out so much of their hair. With the beads, I mean, I understand with the little bead-in extensions or even with the clip-in extensions, these are all things that are just gonna kind of tug on your hair for better or worse. I just don't feel like that's maybe the best solution for you right now. I feel like it just has more potential to do damage and good. And I'm not just making that up. This is just from the plentiful, plentiful things that I've read about women talking about their experience with tape-in hair extensions and the bead hair extension, just hair extensions of all types. If you really want to mess with them, I would say just buy in some clip-ins and just have a look and see how that's working for you. That way you can just take them out, right? This is not like something that's all just stuck in your hair and you're going to have to live with long term, go for the clip-ins. Toppers and wigs. How do I feel about wearing hair toppers, which for those of you who don't know, is almost like a mini wig that just sort of covers up your balding area here. And wigs, how do I feel about that? I am an emphatic yes, yes, yes to these. I think so many women are just unrealistic about what they're hoping to get out. And I'm not trying to take away your hope, but there are women who've lost a lot of hair. And if that's you, my goodness, I know how you feel. I have nothing but sympathy for your plight. But a lot of women say that they just wish they got on the topper bandwagon much earlier and the wig bandwagon. Like almost everybody says, I wish I had started toppers earlier. Very few people say, oh, you know what? I tried toppers and why did I bother doing that? Not too often. So do your research. You know, it doesn't have to be an expensive topper or wig necessarily, but you definitely want to get one that you're going to be happy with. Definitely check out the YouTuber Kim S. She is from Australia. I adore her. She has beautiful wig reviews and you'll just see how gorgeous they look. Like, let me tell you, I've said this before here on my channel. I have a wig that I got more compliments, like from strangers, just like in like Walmart. I got more compliments on that stupid wig than I ever got on my own hair, even when I had a huge head of hair. A good wig will look beautiful. There's nothing to be ashamed of. And as I've also said here before, so many people wear wigs. Kylie Jenner wears wigs. I mean, Ariana Grande wears false ponytails. It's nothing to be embarrassed about anymore. Mindy Kaling is renowned for wearing toppers. And so now that I've told you that, if you go and look at those celebrities, you will not be able to unsee it, but there's nothing to be ashamed of. Go ahead and wear them. Wear them proudly. Hairbrushing. Okay, I'm gonna show you the inexpensive tool that I swear has helped me so, so much through this whole, I've had it for years now. It's helped me so much through this hair loss journey that I'm on and regrowth journey. And it's not the Tangle Teaser because I've shown, oh, look you guys. Oops, cat's out of the bag. It's not the Tangle Teaser that I love. It's just this comb. It's just this fine tooth comb. Honestly, if you have more hair than I do, just go to a sort of more wide tooth, bigger version of this. This is so good. When you don't have a lot of hair, you don't need a big flat hairbrush. You don't need that hairbrush anymore. You maybe don't even need a Tangle Teaser, but you do need a good comb that's gonna help you get through. If you have straighter or wavy hair, if you have really curly hair, don't be trying to pull this through your hair. Just get a much wider tooth comb. But a comb like this really helps to get through the hair. And it helps you to hit that scalp and it feels good. It helps, it's a great styling tool. It will help you part a bit better. It will just really help you hit that scalp. It's really nice to get that feeling of those hair tines like right to your scalp, and it helps to detoxify. Oh, I hate that word, not detoxify, sorry. It helps you to get out all the flakies off your scalp. Sorry to be gross, but all the dry skin and stuff like that. Clarify, it helps to clarify your scalp. So definitely don't be afraid to go in like that, but don't do that unless you brush through your hair. Get right to the scalp. So this is it. Like, what do these cost? Couple bucks? Get one of these. They're really good. Let's talk about thickening shampoo now. I've talked about Vivascal's wonderfully smelling thickening shampoo and conditioner. It's a really nice product. I love the way it smells. It smells like a really high-end shampoo and conditioner. And I've had some others, drugstore ones, more expensive ones. I've tried Kérastase's thickening shampoo, Densifique, I think it's called. Didn't care for it. My take on thickening shampoo is it definitely does do a job of thickening. If you have really bone straight hair, I think that you'll probably be pretty happy with thickening shampoos and conditioners. If you have any kind of drier or textured hair, I have a slight wave in my hair. The problem with that is it makes it dry. So sure, you'll get that volume, but your hair will have definitely, in my experience, a more dry look. And sometimes that's okay if you're just wanting to get some big volume and you're gonna just go in with a sort of leave-in conditioner after. Maybe it can work for you. But my experience is you don't necessarily need thickening shampoo. I would definitely say what you need is a more hydrating shampoo, just depending on your hair type. In my experience though, hydrating shampoo, but one that doesn't leave you with a lot of heaviness is the one you wanna look for. Because oftentimes thinning hair will look a little bit better with a more plumped up strand, in my experience. And the thickening shampoo gives it more of a dry look, which can contribute to sort of like a frizzy look. So I hope that's making sense. So thickening shampoos, you know, they can have a role in this, but they're not the be all and end all. Like, you're not gonna get a thickening shampoo and that's gonna, the problem with that is it's drying, is what I'm trying to say. Sugar bear hair, Tati's Halo Vitamins. What do I think of those? I have experimented with biotin. I do use biotin. I use this one. This one is Nature's Bounty, and this is a huge bottle. If you've been to Costco, you've probably seen this, and I bought it because it's a reasonable price, and I wanted to try biotin. It gives me some acne, though. So that's a common thing that I've heard about biotin. It does give me pimples. When I stop using this, I hardly get any, but not too many, not pimples to the point where I would stop using it, but if you're prone to acne, it may flare it up from what I've read. I use this, does it help or not? I don't know. It's just kind of fun to eat a gummy vitamin every now and again. So I'm gonna say that I've heard people have like the Viviscal supplements. I have no experience using the actual supplements. I've heard, you know, mixed things about Sugar Bear Hair. And also Tati's Halo, have never heard anything good or bad about that. That's just what I've heard. And my experience with biotin, again, not too sure. My nails are still kind of a wreck. So I haven't done anything from my nails, but my hair is looking pretty good. So my last point, and one that comes up quite a bit, and it kind of frustrates me, and I see this a lot in the Facebook group that I belong to, is, and I'll drop a link to the Facebook group that I'm talking about, it's Thin Hair Loss and Hair Loss Solutions, I believe is the name of it, is nutrition. People are like, you need to switch to an organic diet, you're not eating enough meat, you're eating too much meat. Maybe. It's possible. You know, there's people there with eating disorders. I don't want to take away from that. There's people who are vegans. I don't want to take away from that experience. Or people that are on a strict keto diet, which I'll talk about in a second. But there's a lot of nutrition shaming and a lot of misinformation that goes around. And I'm going to say, in my own experience, my diet varies. I'm just a normal human. Sometimes it's great. And sometimes I, you know, am eating out quite a bit. You know, when I'm vacationing, I'm not eating as well as I am when I'm at home. I don't feel like that has ever made a huge difference. You know, the literature that I've read and the things that I've heard from credible sources like dermatologists do not suggest that nutrition, like a sort of okay diet, I'm not saying it has to be perfect nor imperfect, has had a huge effect either way. So I don't really think that if you switch to only organics, your hair is going to be fantastic all of a sudden, or vice versa. I mean, walk down your street and look, you'll see people literally eating fast food and they have a beautiful head of hair. So like, you don't have to be perfect. I think that we have this sort of clean eating obsession sometimes and we think that that's the cure all for everything. Please, if clean eating could cure everything, then there would be no disease right now because everybody would do it and life would be perfect. But we're humans and we're a little more complicated than that. I will say a word to the wise though about the keto diet. I have experimented with the keto diet. Also talked about that here on this channel, and honestly, I feel like I have read enough stuff to make me believe that the keto diet can contribute to hair loss. Definitely people have left comments on my channel saying their dermatologist has said the keto diet will contribute to hair loss because it's just a shock to the system. I'm not describing it in complete medical terms, but it's just very hard on the system. And with nutrient loss and stuff like that, you can see more hair shed than you normally would. So I would say if you're considering the keto diet, you know, I am into intuitive eating, but I would can say that if you're using the keto diet and you've got a lot of hair loss, that might be something to ask your healthcare practitioner about. All right, everybody, that's everything. That was a big, huge jumbo edition. I do hope that if you found anything here that was useful, you'll give me a like and subscribe. That helps me know that you like this content. I keep making more of it. I just want to wish you all so much the best and thank you so much for spending your time with me. Until next time, we'll see you soon.